When the other guys of Drive go on the road, I, like you, get inspired by their work. Chris Harris driving the 1987 Le Mans winning Porsche 962C. And Mike Spinelli traveling to the Paris Auto Show reporting on the McLaren P1 on jalopnik.com and here on Drive. When I say inspired, I mean I want to know more about those cars, which gets me to today's shakedown and our topic, ground effects in race cars and road cars. Looking at the subject through the lens of the Porsche 956 and 962 race cars, they were actually a Porsche cash cow, as the 962 was a customer race car, like today's 911 GT3. But 962 was the ultimate customer sports racing car because it was the first to sell ground effects. And the new McLaren P1, which is being marketed as the ultimate road car, providing race car performance for the street because the foundation of its design is driven by race car aerodynamics, downforce, and ground effects. Now, I'm not ignoring this weekend's racing action. McLaren's next race is in Japan, the Suzuka F1 race, and the Aussie V8 supercars at the Bathurst 1000, celebrating its 50-year anniversary. We'll cover them both next week. And you'll watch them this weekend, because V8 supercars is what NASCAR should be. And come on, NASCAR, there should be at least one road race in the final 10 race chase for the championship season-ending miniseries. And the racetrack for V8 supercars, Mount Panorama, is a racer's soul search of elevation changes and blind corners. And the V8 supercars themselves are mega cool. And of course, the Aussie grid girls are some of the best in racing. In Japan, the championship battle for F1 stays intense among the top six. Alonso Ferrari fighting off the McLaren and Red Bull boys, and Kimi's Lotus is P3. Now, Button McLaren won last year's Suzuka race, but he's docked 5 spots this race because of a gearbox change penalty. Alonso finished P2 last year, Vettel P3. And we can all watch Hamilton's throwdown of attitude this year as he drives his last races for McLaren, with his eye on the future that he has with the Mercedes team. When we come back, we'll get down with downforce. That sucked. And I'll explain what this photo has to do with Chris Harris's 962 Le Mans car and Mike Spinelli's McLaren P1. That last image, this image, was one of those Russian Caspian Sea Monster Ekranoplan ground effects, not an aircraft, but definitely something, using air management to move about. And this thing is the American answer, the Boeing Pelican, 500 feet of wingspan of heavy, heavy lifting transport equipment, moving ground effect aero techie thing that we built, or are building. Where am I going with all this? To look at downforce management in cars by explaining as simply as possible what ground effects is. And I'm starting using these sea monsters. Ground effects is the interaction of a flat surface, the ground, or the water, in close proximity to a wing. The effect is that the ground enhances the wing's effectiveness and reduces drag. Because of what the ground does to the vortices coming off the ends of the wing and the pressure area between the wing and the ground. For an Ekranoplan, it creates more lift with a smaller wing. For a car, ground effects creates downforce, the load on the tires, by using the underbody as a reversed wing, with less drag versus the add-on wings and spoilers you see on other cars. Quickly, an airplane wing creates lift by having a low pressure area forming on the rounded surface and a high pressure push from the coved side. Turn the wing over, and for a car, you create downforce. The vortex spinning off the end of the wing, in either case, A, tries to fill in the low pressure and thereby reduce its effectiveness, it lift or downforce, and B, creates drag by spinning the air behind the wing, making friction of some sort. In the late 1960s and 70s, F1 designers started to play with aero, downforce, and ground effects, using not just wings attached to the cars, but the entire car, the undersurface. And the first example was a guy named Tony Wright at BRM, the old English F1 team. In 1968, he built this wind tunnel model. The real race car was never built, and Wright ended up at Lotus. Hold that thought. Here's the March 701 with its wing-shaped fuel tanks. And Gordon Murray at Brabham with his BT42 and 44 race cars, who went pyramid with the bodywork to lower the air separation location to reduce lift, then put a skirt under the car to try to reduce more lift by stopping air slipping under the car. Instead, he discovered that he had created a low-pressure area under the car, sealing the car, and not just reducing lift, but actually creating downforce. Oh, and small world that it is, Gordon Murray eventually found his way to McLaren, and besides designing the mega-winning F1 cars, did the McLaren F1 road car, the inspiration for today's P1. And here's the speed of technology. Murray was God for hitting a downforce target of 160 pounds at 150 miles an hour with the F1. The P1 snaps off 1,300 pounds at 125 miles an hour. And then there was Lotus F1, where Wright, the ex-BRM guy, and that model ended up helping Colin Chapman define ground effects and the aerodynamic underbody tunnels, which gets us back to the Porsche 956, 962 cars. 1982 and beyond, into the 90s they raced. 1982 through 1987 at Le Mans, 6 years, six straight wins. Plus a seventh in 1994 when a car builder named Dower created a final entry for the 962 as a production car and claimed victory one final time for this fabled Porsche. As Porsche engineer and designer Norbert Singer said in the Chris Harris video, the 956, 962 cars were one of the first and certainly the most successful of the first generation downforce sports cars. And as a customer race car, they sold 100 or so. 962 won all over the globe. And to get that success, Porsche worked hard to get control of the flow of air over and under the car. The underbody tunnel was the prime factor to get that downforce, but the flat six turbo motor that Porsche makes, and by the way, it was only 2.8 liter, but it generated 680 horsepower, 490 pound-feet of torque. That was the motor in Chris's car. But the flat six created aero issues, taking space that could be used for the tunnels, blowing more air through the diffusers. So over the years, customers and Porsche worked to make the tunnels bigger, and bigger still. This one's over the rear axle. And if you listen to Norbert in the Harris video, he also talks about managing the airflow on the edges, the sides of the car, the vortices, to use them to make more downforce and less drag. Remember that whole Ekranoplan discussion? Then there was Norbert Singer's mention of the rear gurney, how it affected the front of the car. Because a big factor in getting ground effects to work effectively is managing the center of pressure, exactly where the car is most planted. And influencing and controlling that spot of the strongest interaction of high and low pressures is a big deal on how to get the car to feel good, how to make the driver confident, and how the car corners. So gurneys begat diffusers, and strakes in the diffusers, and spats, and aero shapes all over the car. Anything to manage the air and the airflow. Not just over and under the car, but through the car as well. Audi with their R18 race cars make a big deal about that. And so does McLaren with their P1 road car. These pre-Paris Auto Show teaser images tip their hand about airflow. The P1 is truly the extension of everything everyone in racing, especially McLaren, has learned over all the years and all the designers, including Gordon Murray in his early McLaren Aero days. Now, the first thing you notice in the P1 is the shrink wrapping of the bodywork over the mechanicals, just like an F1 car. And this does two things: smaller profile and the smallest supercar frontal area to pierce the wind as unobtrusively as possible. And the front of the car is not about engine intake, that's for the doors of all things, but the air management around the front tires, through the car for cooling, and out the hood for pressure relief to negate lift. Plus, check out the details of the front splitter and the little side fences, the shapes right behind the back of the front wheel wells, and the back of the front wheel well as well. Air management and managing, I think, the vortices down the side of the car to create air fences to seal the underbody ground effects tunnels. P1's anticipated to have a V8 with KERS that will not intrude in the tunnel designs, making them bigger and more aggressive as ever, and not like the fat, flat six-cylinder did here on the Porsche tunnel. And aero knowledge evolved, so now we have the side air as a fence, not a source of more air for the tunnel, as Norbert suggested with the 962C. Add in the active underbody gurneys that, like the Porsche tail gurney, to manage and control the center of pressure, plus add downforce, and you get a car, the P1, that will make five times the downforce as the MP412C, that when I drove it at Spa, seemed pretty planted to me. So this P1 should be awesome. The rear fenders are sharp-edged and, to me, look like end plates or fences to move the air to the center of the car for that big active wing, which, by the way, is also going to have a DRS function as well. And the fence concept reminds me of the 1970s McLaren Can-Am cars. So that gets us to the rear diffuser tunnels, which F1 tech tells us is really the most critical of areas to max out downforce and efficiency. That P1, suitably functional looking, I'd say. The P1 has a 0.34 drag coefficient, and that's not bad, but it's also not Prius brilliant either. That's because the goal of the P1 is not lowest drag and Vmax. It's downforce, balance, and complete performance. And frankly, all this race car technology becomes a very effective functionally effective branding exercise for McLaren to define their performance spot in the hypercar market. They'd probably say, "Hi, we are McLaren. We design, engineer, and build winning race cars. Racing's not just marketing to us. It's our cars. It's what we do. And we'll share all we know with you as a McLaren owner, partner. Now, others may race. Others may build race cars. But we, McLaren, give you the strongest direct connection to our racing technology." They just did their infomercial. They very well may have done that with the P1 in the spirit of the Porsche 962C and its lineage back to Porsche Aero and Turbo 6 technology. But I know one thing they, McLaren, also did is make me want to drive the P1, not watch Chris or Mike do so. So McLaren, tell me you're listening. I'll even share the ride with Chris, Mike, or JF. But here's the question for you guys. If you've stuck through this little classroom, tell me what you think about cars, road cars. Do you like this connection to race car technology, or do you want a car to be more aesthetically beautiful and not be form following function? How many of you like the McLaren P1? How many of you like the technology? How many of you prefer to have a beautiful road car and really don't need all that mega hyper aerodynamic thing going on for your road car? That's the question I'm curious of. Let me know.